Yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, you are listening to O Culture, where our Pluto is in Scorpio, and that does not mean we are lazy, debt-ridden basement dwellers, but instead, that we are here to put an end to the conspiracy against all things magical. I am your host, Ryan Peverly. Welcome to the show. Thanks for hanging. Our guest this time around is Dr. Carolyn Elliott. Carolyn has a PhD Player Hayton degree in Critical and Cultural Studies from the University of Pittsburgh. Her dissertation ended up as the basis for the cult favorite book on creativity called Awaken Your Genius. Carolyn is also the founder of Witch Magazine, which gives voice and prominence to the subtle witching in the world that's not confined to tradition and convention. Carolyn's also the teacher of Influence, a course on mastering practical magic. All in all, Carolyn's professional ventures aim to help people achieve dramatic positive change in their lives through shadow integration practices and applied occult philosophy. Carolyn is in the house because I came across an article she wrote for Witch Magazine a few months back called The 5 Keys to Understanding the Conspiracy Against Magic. And that article led me to a free ebook that she co-wrote called Pluto in Scorpio, which is an occult look at the millennial generation, of which I am proud to be part of. Both these pieces of writing are the basis for the conversation you're about to hear. It's full of magic and psychology. We talk about the fear of the feminine and even the alchemy of Oprah. And if you don't mind a few Skype gremlins and sexual innuendos, you'll like this one quite a bit. So enough prologue, let's flip this script to dialogue and do this damn thing already. Enjoy! Carolyn Elliott, thank you so much for being here.
My pleasure. My joy, I almost said. It is my pleasure and my joy, and I'm nervous right now.
You've done this before. There's no need to be nervous. So let's start with a little bit about you. I pulled this from somewhere. You call yourself a sheer gleeful bad bitch and bad witch. So take us through that journey. How did you get to be this, you know, sheer gleeful bad bitch and bad witch? You know, where did that journey begin for you?
Oh, wow. What an excellent question. You know, I think it had something to do with, I was part of a sex cult for a while. Oh boy, maybe it doesn't start there. Let me dial it back.
Well, hey, wait, hold on. So that's okay. You can't just throw out sex cult and then not address that. Was that by choice or was that a forced thing?
No. Oh, no, totally by choice. I hesitate when speaking about it because I don't want to cross any legal lines, but there was an organization I was involved with, which is a pretty prominent organization. There were articles in the New York Times about it. There were a lot of, I would name it, but I can't because I just called it a cult. And now I'm like, it is.
Yeah.
And it teaches a specific practice of sexual meditation, which is great. It's a wonderful practice. It's a partnered practice that involves clitoral stroking. And I learned a whole lot from this organization / cult. I mean, that's the thing about cults is they can't be totally bad or else nobody would join them.
I suppose that is true, yes.
It's true. And I learned a lot from them. And one of the things that I learned, one of the things that made them so powerful, they really had a way of approving of things in people, the kinds of things that we resist giving approval to. And this was a huge gift that they gave me, actually, because they kind of recognized and saw in me that I have a bit of a predator in me. I have this kind of like insatiable, I will go after what I want and I will get it part of me that I was always ashamed of, but because it doesn't match the love and light, whatever, that I tend to tell myself that I should be. So through my experience with that group and working my way out of it and everything like that, sorry that this is such a vague story, I just came to realize that I don't want to shame any part of myself ever, even my wickedness or my violence or my ruthlessness. And I don't want to shame those qualities in anybody else either. I'm sort of like have a buck stops here policy for shaming. Like there's nothing that I want to see shamed in the world.
Yeah. And I think that probably this is a topic I wanted to touch on later, but I guess maybe we could talk about it now. You have a vested interest of sorts in shadow integration. It's one of the things I've heard you talk and write a lot about. And that's essentially what you're describing is kind of embracing your own wickedness, right? And then just kind of making it part of you, making it a proud part of you.
Yes, exactly. And there's so much there that I feel like, well, we could talk a lot about it, but I feel like it's so huge. It's such an important message, maybe even especially for women, because there's, in our society, there's so many parts of ourselves that we are conditioned to feel are unacceptable or make us unlovable. And those parts are actually have a great deal to do with what's actually powerful and forceful in us. So, yes.
Well, I know a few people in my life. I will say that you share a gender with them, but they are pretty sexually repressed. And I find that to be disempowering to them. And I don't know what you think about that, but to me, it seems like they don't embrace that side of them. They shun it. But then at the same time, they see the world as over-sexualized. And that's more of a cultural repression, probably. But just in their own individual lives, I've seen that affect them to the point where it's not destroying them completely, but it is definitely causing a lot of discomfort and a lot of stress. And just wondering, you know, as a female, as somebody who has, I guess, been in a sex cult and embraced that side of your existence, what advice do you have to women out there on how to, I don't know, come to terms with that or accept that about themselves?
Excellent question. Well, first of all, I think it is important as much as possible for women to realize that even though our culture has a lot of emphasis on sex in it, I would even say actually an emphasis on pornography as opposed to actual erotics or intimacy, which is very feared by our society. But the pornographic emphasis in that we see patriarchy, of course, it gives us this feeling that there's something poisonous about our sexuality, like our female feminine sexuality is somehow dangerous or destabilizing, or it could just like men could just be overwhelmed with desire and lose their minds. And we are somehow responsible for this bringing out the worst in men. Like somehow as women, we could be responsible for our own sexual assault or our own harassment. And if, I mean, it's a many-sided picture here because I feel like part of the reason why sexual assault and harassment is such a prevalent thing in our culture is because, you know, men, basically everybody gets shamed for their sexuality and everybody gets into this alienated kind of condition. And this one of the solutions to that, a big part of it, I feel like, is just to become unconditionally willing to experience sensation in my body without going unconscious. So what I mean by that is that when there's a high amount of sensation, sexual or emotional or otherwise, we as humans tend to want to avoid that either by going to sleep or making a joke and dissipating the tension or going into daydreams or projections about the past or the future. Basically, we'll do anything to avoid the sensation of the present moment, especially when it's intense sensation. So there's a piece here about being willing to be present with one's own sexuality, even with the fears or the feelings that there's something poisonous or dangerous here. And I'm not sure, I hope I didn't just ramble for that question, Ryan, because it is such a deep, deep piece. But I think maybe that's the beginning part of my advice.
You know, we got plenty of time here, and not to make a pun, but you can go as deep as you want, to be honest. So if there's more to say about it, please do. I'm not going to restrict you.
Okay, sure. I guess maybe it's I'm just trying to remember my own process, and it's always hard because it becomes like an unconscious competency, you know, and so like trying to pull it out and make it a more conscious competency in order to teach it to others, it's a bit of a challenge. But at one point, I made the decision to stop protecting other people, to stop protecting them from feeling the energy and the electricity of my being and my presence and my sexuality, even if they found it intimidating or overwhelming. And when I made that decision and kept following up on that decision again and again, like always asking myself, am I trying to protect people from me? And is there a way that I can drop that, trying to protect people from feeling me? The more I did that, the more present I became in my body and my sexuality.
That's a great piece of advice. It's practical, not just for women. I think a lot of men can learn something from that too.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I think also salespeople, business people, because this was a huge thing for me with running my business and making money, is that the exchange of money, the exchange of value is also sensational. And there's a tendency for me to try to protect people from the sensation of valuing me or desiring me. So when I stop doing that as a business person, I energetically open up to so much more possibility and connection and opportunity.
Well, I know that if we didn't hook people with sex cult up front here, then we did not do our jobs properly here. But I do want to go back, though, to, you know, where this journey started for you. There's a tidbit on your website, I believe, in your bio, where you say that you were dedicated to Thoth in a Rosicrucian temple as a kid. I don't know if that's accurate, but I'd love to hear that story if you remember it.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's definitely accurate. I mean, my father belonged to the Rosicrucians, and I was a clone in their temple, that's what they call it, which is when you're like a 10, 11, 12-year-old girl and they put you in white robes and give you an incense censer and tell you that you, with your purity, are the channel of the god Thoth. And there's a dedication ceremony. So that all totally happened. My father, I like to say about my father never met a cult he didn't like. So my father was involved in multiple cults.
Yeah, sorry, I find that to be pretty funny. Go ahead.
It is funny. It's the Eliot love of cults is just strong. But he was in multiple ones in California before he met my mom and settled down and had me. And then when I was growing up, my mother would have me go to church and Sunday school, Catholic church and Catholic Sunday school. And my father would just take me to every single weird thing in town. You know, the Rosicrucians, the Wiccans, the Druids, tarot card readers, the A Course in Miracles people, the people talking to mermaids and channeling Atlantis, just everything. So I had a pretty strong cult childhood, I would say.
When did you, I guess, first discover witchcraft or magic, and when did you make that part of your life?
Yes, another excellent question. So as I said, I'd been exposed to Wiccan stuff growing up. I had an altar in my room, and my father and I went to celebrations of all the Sabbats. But when I was in my early 20s, I started distancing myself from it because I put it under the heading of like dorky stuff that my dad is into. And I set about trying to be a normal, respectable person. So I joined a Presbyterian church and was, I don't even know what I was doing. I was trying to be spiritually respectful. But along within that process, I came in touch with a group of people with an organization called Evolver, which was run by Daniel Pinchbeck, who wrote 2012 Time for Change.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And so I just kind of stumbled upon this group one night. They were throwing an awesome party. They had fire spinners and massage tables and face painting. And I'd been thinking that I wanted to throw cool parties. And I came into this party and I was like, hey, who threw this? And they introduced me to the Evolver folks. And that organization became a big part of my life for a few years. And what happened is we would throw these really psychedelic, sort of like mini Burning Man parties. We threw summer solstice parties specifically on this big plateau that's in my hometown of Pittsburgh, which overlooks the city and is kind of like a land of the lost. Like it's a public park, but there's nobody ever there. And it's just kind of like this wild pagan place. So we'd have these parties, and every year for the climax of the party at midnight, we would do some sort of magical ritual, except we didn't really call it that at first. We said, you know, this is like a theatrical presentation. We're pretending to do a magical ritual. And sort of to make a long story short, I just very concretely noticed over the years that whatever magical ritual we did at midnight on solstice, had such a huge effect on my life and the life of the whole community in the next year. And it just gradually became undeniable to me that there is a direct connection between symbolic ritual actions and unfolding stories and dramas in my world. So I began to get, I think for the first time, really super intellectually curious about magic, about like, what is that relationship between this symbolic performance and these actual events that are unfolding, and what is going on here? So at the time, I was also in a PhD program for critical and cultural studies. And I was just reading a lot of far out stuff, Emerson, Nietzsche, Heidegger, Jung, all of this stuff about consciousness and perception and the psyche and symbol and poetry. So that was all going on. And then I got involved with the sex cult organization, which also really, which I would talk to them about my experiences with magic. And they would be like, oh, yeah, well, that's because you have this electricity in your body and you're able to make things happen with this, basically like the energy of female orgasm, the energy of, and not orgasm in the sense of climax, but in the sense of like the whole range of Kundalini, basically, or Shakti, you could call it, and sort of brought my attention to how powerful I was as a creative force. And I started to get this idea of witchcraft and what being a witch was, which, you know, I hadn't seen in any book, which was far more about the integration of one's psyche and one's ability to shift reality than it was necessarily about like velour dresses and crystal wands and Renaissance fair stylings. So, yeah.
Yeah, I have a note here. I wrote down, I've heard you define the word witch before, you know, what you think a witch is. So could you please tell us what that definition is? Did you just touch on that, or is there more to it?
Oh, well, there's a lot that can be said about it. I mean, so I basically see a witch as somebody who's a fully developed human, in the sense that a witch is someone who makes deliberate efforts to make the unconscious conscious. So to connect with that larger, conventionally unseen part of oneself, which tends to be where one's creative power is. So that includes what Jung called the shadow. And that also includes the divine, because basically the unconscious is just everything that we don't habitually, normally identify ourselves with. So the more, maybe I'm not giving the concise and pithy definition of witch today, but I see witches as just being people who have an open channel of communication between the conscious and the unconscious. You know, like Lon-Milo Duquette is one of my favorite occult authors. I love him. And he has a line where he says something like, of course, magic is all in your head, except your head is just a lot bigger than you think it is. In it's everything, right? Everything happens within consciousness. Yeah. So does that answer, did that get us where we wanted to go, Ryan?
Yeah, that's the answer I was looking for. A really unique way to describe a witch, because, you know, like you said, I think the common perception of what a witch is, I mean, it's probably not cauldron and pointy hat anymore, but it's probably not too far from that, you know. So I have this, it's not like an original thought, but I see everybody as, they're a magician, they're an alchemist, they're a witch. Like, everybody has that inside of them. And if you're consciously working towards being a better person every day, you're being a witch. You're using magic, you're using alchemy. Like, you're doing those processes inside of you, whether you acknowledge it that way or not.
Oh, yes. And I think it's so fascinating. Some of the very most powerful witches and magicians in the world would never identify with those terms. I think about people like Elon Musk or Oprah or anybody who's like exerting their will in the world in a really concentrated kind of amazing way. Yeah, that's what it comes down to. That's change, you know, making change happen in accord with will.
All those cars that Oprah gave away for all those years probably were paid for with alchemical gold, if I had to guess.
Purely alchemical gold. I mean, Oprah's one of my favorite examples because she literally took all of this really painful lead in her being, in her childhood, you know, being raped, being abandoned, being put down as a Black woman in America. And through the light of her, you know, her consciousness and her heart, her goodwill, she transformed that alchemically with compassion and made all of that lead into wealth that let other people trust her and welcome her and made her such a great interviewer and made her the richest woman in the world.
You don't think there's anything shady about her? Like,
oh, here's
just in terms of, like, you know, just like too much success. Like, there's got to be some skeletons in her closet, right?
The very fact that you would think that just points to how suspicious we still are of witches.
Well, I mean, I don't think of Oprah as a witch necessarily. Like, I guess, okay, never mind. I do think of Oprah as a witch because I just said that everybody was a witch. But I guess I was more like going towards a conspiratorial avenue. Like, she's been a celebrity, and usually all these celebrities, you know, they have some sort of dark, demonic past, you know, some skeletons in the closet. Or it could be something, you know, just like they've been groping people for 20 years, whatever. But you don't think there's anything shady about her?
I hear you. Maybe there's something immensely shady about her, but even if there is, she's still a very, I mean, here's what I'm saying about, like, how suspicious of witches we are. I'm defining witch just loosely, temporarily right now, as a woman or anybody else, but let's just say woman right now, who is scary powerful. She did all of that stuff. It's so big, I can't even wrap my mind around it or imagine how a person could accomplish that without being shady and evil somehow.
Yeah, and I think that does speak to a larger trend that we are afraid of the power of the feminine, not just a woman in gender, but also, you know, men and their sort of fear of embracing their own feminine aspects. Would you agree with that?
Oh, absolutely. Hugely. In fact, I mean, I think there's such a correlation, actually, between fear of magic and the fear of the feminine. Because they're essentially, I mean, often in my mind, they're pretty much the same thing. They're like this creative, unpredictable, sort of generative, surprising, moving force that doesn't submit itself to, you know, quantification and rationalization. So to the exact degree that our culture fears the mystical and the magical and shames it, I think it does that also to the feminine within all of us.
Well, this is a great segue into the first piece of writing that I saw from you that took me to your website, badwitch.es, bad witches, obviously, was this piece you wrote a couple of months ago called The Conspiracy Against Magic. Or, you know, that might not have been the actual title. That's my notes here. It's actually called Five Keys to Understanding the Conspiracy Against Magic. And you had a list of five things. And if you remember them, that's great. If not, that's fine too. But I love to talk about them. We actually just touched on one a little bit, and just in terms of this conspiracy against the feminine. But I did want to call attention to this article because I thought it was really cool, and I thought that you made some great points in there. So you start the article, you're writing about how you think conspiracy theories can tend to be a bit immature, and I agree with you there. You actually wrote, I'm going to quote you if you don't mind. You wrote that, I think these conspiracy theories fail as plausible constructs of reality because they avoid the stark fact that evil and ignorance of all flavors are very widespread human attributes, and that we are all, every last one of us, is implicated in and responsible for the world's ills. Could not have said it better. Completely agree with you. I was a conspiracy theorist for the last several years, and I realized it never did any good for me. It kept me in a state of fear and paranoia and distracted me from just being a better person in my day-to-day life and working to make, you know, my Monday better, my Tuesday better, and so on. I was so concerned with what was going on outside of me that I ignored what was going on inside of me. So back to your article, though, if you don't mind, can we pull out these 5 points and talk about them a bit?
Oh, please. Yes, I just brought them up. And I just want to say, Ryan, I really feel you there. Like, the paranoia, the whole risk of paranoia, I think is quite big whenever we enter into a more magical worldview, because we just become more sensitive to the connections and the interrelations between things. And I do think it is so important to, I like to maintain something the astrologer Rob Bresnay calls pronoia, like always looking for the ways in which the universe is conspiring to benefit me. And I think it is a key to magical mental health thing. But yes, anyways, let's go into thinking about the conspiracy against magic.
Yes, yes, yes. So the first one, and I'll just read it, I guess, as you wrote it, but governments and corporations relentlessly use the tools of magic, symbols, mantras, and ritual to control people's actions. My quick comment on that, hell yes, I work in marketing and advertising. I know how it works. You obviously have to dabble in that world as well, just, you know, promoting your own business. So you know how it works. For people that aren't aware of how magic works in their own day-to-day lives, please do give us a nice little crash course on that.
Sure. Well, it's funny because the notion that we are just all logical actors who are only affected by our deductive reasoning and we all always act in our own interests is this really bizarre idea that's kind of perpetrated in our culture's scientific materialism. But actually, we're all being governed by the symbols that we pay attention to at any given time. The symbols, the stories, the narratives that surround us or that surrounded us growing up are such a huge part of why we do what we do. And I think this is a very difficult thing for most people to admit. We want to believe that we're in control of our choices and our decisions and our spending and our political beliefs and whatnot. But I would say to a gigantic extent, we are manipulated. And the more humble we're willing to be about that and the more willing we're willing to see, sorry, I'm getting a bit excited, so ahead of myself, but the more willing we are to see the impact that the stories and the symbols and the marketing messages have on us, and understand that we're vulnerable to it, the more we can develop the strength and the imagination and the will to create our own symbols and narratives and our counter magic, basically. So, yeah, I don't know if it's just so obvious to me that magic is being used constantly by corporations, by the government. So for anybody to deny that it's real or that it's in operation is, I don't know, just strange to me.
I see on a daily basis the amount of money that I call it wasted, because the millions of dollars that get poured into just where I work for people to try to get a message in front of you. I mean, holy shit. If that did not work on some level and did not return their investment into it, they wouldn't be doing it. So that's just a pretty, I think, logical way to approach that. Just in terms of marketing, and I call it propaganda, but whatever. just a quote here from you from this piece that you wrote. You said, quote, "And what do you call sigils and spells used to control the actions of others without regard to those persons' well-being? Well, you call that black magic." And that's exactly how I look at it, too. So you also said black magic doesn't need any occult trappings to work perfectly. And I go to work in jeans and a t-shirt every day. I'm not dressed like a magician or a witch or anything. So I hate to say that because I'm not trying to manipulate people on any level. But for fuck's sake, I have to make some money too, you know?
Well, right. So we all do. So that's another thing, is that we were all born into this culture and we're all implicated in it. Sometimes people are moved to go live off the grid and try to extract themselves as much as possible from this crazy culture we live in. But I almost think it's more interesting to, like, hang around and try to move within it. So the next thing that rings a bell for me is there being a conspiracy against magic. And when I say conspiracy against magic, what I mean is basically that whatever, you know, the authorities, the forces in power in our society, like the banks, the schools, the government, the corporations, just the whole everything, they don't want us to know that we as individuals also have magical power and influence. And the more they can take that awareness away from us, like the more defenseless we are to their spells and their magic. So the whole idea of, like, for example, the American dollar, it's only worth something because we believe it's worth something. Right? It's kind of like this shared illusion. It doesn't have intrinsic worth. It's not like water, which you can drink and which will grow things. It's not like food. It's just an idea. And currency is becoming even more interesting, right, in this day of like digital banking and cryptocurrencies and all of this stuff, where it literally is just kind of like numbers and codes and digits. So one of the reasons that why cryptocurrency is exciting is because it offers up the possibility that, hey, maybe we could have exchanges of value that aren't controlled by governments. So it sort of democratizes the magic of currency a little bit. But either way you shake it, it's all just woven out of belief.
That is the second point that you make here, is that currency is a spell. You wrote that it's actually the most amazing practical spell ever cast in the world. And then you wrote this sentence, the Sumerian magicians who initiated it knew exactly what they were doing. That's a curious statement to me. Why are you bringing ancient Sumerians into this?
Well, let's see if I can remember correctly. I'm pretty sure that Babylon was one of the first places where they created a currency based on surplus value or stored value. So that Babylon was the first culture that was an agricultural culture, and therefore they could store up the grain and lock it into silos and create artificial scarcity of grain so that people had to pay for it. Basically, one of the first examples of capitalism in action, like creating supply and demand and creating an economy that is, like I said, where there's a spell of artificial scarcity being cast. And I'm pretty sure they had some of the first currency, actually, but I don't have my sources and my history right in front of me right now. And in a way, in the article, when I'm talking about the Sumerian magicians, it's almost, even if, like, in the context of the essay, it could even just be a figure of speech for, like, the ancient, far-off magicians who made these decisions. We may not even know exactly who they were or what culture they were in or the precise moment that it came about, but we can pretty easily imagine that at one point, there wasn't such a thing as currency or debt or profit. And at another point, there was. There was this idea of separation and this idea that rather than simply sharing and receiving, we needed to manipulate in a different way how value moved through a group.
And if I'm not mistaken, I think usury was outlawed in the early days of Christianity just because it was considered to be a very sort of evil practice to charge somebody interest on something.
Right. So usury is a fascinating subject. There's a great book called The Gift by Lewis Hyde, which really goes into depth about the dynamics of charging interest and what happens when that's done. Yeah, usury has this weird effect of creating an inside and an outside. So like inside the in-group, there might just be, you know, gifting. But then the idea of usury, the idea of charging interest on loaned money is, I'm going to give you this value, but I don't trust that you're in my group enough that my giving this to you will eventually return and reward me. So I mean, there has to be a way of quantifying and codifying the natural return of what would otherwise be a gift. But there's a natural benefit that comes in gift relationships, is basically what Lewis Hyde says in The Gift. And that natural return really can't be quantified, but usury tries to quantify it. Charging interest tries to quantify it. And it creates a barrier. It creates just a sense of separation and distrust between the giver and the receiver in such a transaction.
Going back to the mention of, you know, Babylon and Sumer and the magicians, you know, it's funny how those cultures, and you can bring in probably Egypt too, are revered in the occult space. You know, like they're revered for their lost knowledge and their spiritual teachings. And I can't help but wonder now, after just thinking about this for the last 5 minutes, if maybe the reason they're sort of propped up in the alternative communities is because of this contribution, because maybe we have elite occultists, you know, kind of pulling the strings. And I don't think that's a far-fetched hypothesis, but if the financial system is the one, it's implemented by them and it benefits them, and they sort of prop up these teachings from these ancient cultures as like, this is the most ancient esoteric wisdom. But when you look back, like Egypt, for example, there was a large wealth gap between the pharaohs and the slaves.
Right. Yes.
I mean, like, first of all, they had fucking slaves. Like, have we not... like we're overlooking that. So
it's very true. And the Babylonians enslaved the Jews, and yeah, all sorts of stuff that's kind of fucked up when you think about it. And that does, I think you're onto something huge there, Ryan, which that does kind of give you pause. Like, wait a second, should I really be seeking to emulate and enact the same kind of magic that created these inequalities? I think that's a really important question. A really fascinating book came out in 2017 called The Game of Saturn from Scarlet Imprint.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Peter Mark Adams.
Yeah. So that book also shines a really interesting spotlight, I think, on the same thing that you're referencing, which is the ways that really specific occult things from ancient Greece, ancient Egypt, moved through the European Renaissance to create the current economy and the current kind of power structures that we now have. So yeah, I think that that's something to be sensitive to and alert to and inquisitive about.
Well, too, you know, like, I've seen some people criticize, you know, like, bringing Thoth back into this, Thoth slash Hermes, I guess. Mm-hmm. I've seen some people criticize the invention of writing, which he's credited with. Now, granted, you know, I love writing, I love reading, so it's like, well, I don't want to criticize it too much, but on the flip side of that, if I had to criticize it, well, it does sort of diminish our ability to use our own memory to its fullest potential. We don't have to remember things anymore, we can just write them down and read them later. Mm-hmm. And it kind of takes us away from that oral tradition of passing, you know, wisdom from ear to ear. So if we can criticize that, we should also criticize the rest of the culture that led to enslavement of populations and created this, you know, financial system that clearly there's a large wealth disparity right now in our own country here in the U.S. So, yeah, it's an interesting point. So I didn't mean to take us too far off topic there.
Oh, I love it. I love it because it is so huge. Like, writing is so dangerous. I remember Plato talked about how writing is a pharmacon. It's a drug. It's a medicine that can heal or it can make you crazy. It can alter your awareness, alter your consciousness. And it's magic for that reason. And as we're talking about this, though, something that is coming into my mind that I think is important is, I think there's often a yearning amongst spiritually inclined people to try to recover some, like, pure thing, like something purely good, purely unproblematic, purely beautiful, some kind of magic that was, or some sort of culture that existed on the earth that we could look to and we can point to and be like, that's the way that we should be. That's how everything should be. And I just actually don't think that that exists. I think that we have to still create that beautiful wholeness. And I think they're as fucked up as our world is, I would never want to not have it be this way. Like, there's something about our current economy and the wars and all of the very dark things that are present on this earth right now that are also completely necessary and completely beautiful and completely important. I don't know if are you kind of like picking up what I'm trying to say here, Ryan?
I'm totally getting it. Yeah. Picking up what you're putting down for sure. And one more point though, that I wanted to make on the currency before we move on is this guy, Ruan. I'm going to butcher his last name, but I think it's Mipelago who.
Yeah. Ruan. Yes. I have trouble with his last name too.
Right. So yeah, he actually contributed a post to your site, Bad Witch. And he also hosts a podcast called Rwanda. That's a pretty nice show. I think you've been on there before, but he had an article related to this topic that we're talking about, this topic of currency as a spell. And one of the points he made in it was that the primary currency of business is attention. It's not the first time I've heard this, but it's a bit of a recent synchronicity for me personally. I actually just had a conversation the other day with someone, and I was trying to explain how energy was currency, and that our use of language actually proves that, because we always say you need to pay attention as if it's a transaction of sorts. And it is. It's an energetic transaction. So just when you think about what other context do we use the verb pay in, it's always a financial transaction. So your attention, your focus is you putting your energy into whatever you're focusing on. It's giving your energetic currency to something else. So I just wanted to throw that out there. You can comment on it or we can just move on. But I just thought that was an interesting sort of synchronistic nugget there.
Oh, yeah. It's a fascinating point. I mean, the power of attention. When you think about, as you were saying, like, you witness at your place of work all of the money and the effort that goes into getting people's attention. And there's a certain way in which if you can absorb somebody's attention, you own them. I mean, you don't have to put them in a physical prison. You just own them because you have their total attention. And there's certainly ways in which, like, the, I guess you could say, the more primitive parts of our mind or being can be pretty easily manipulated to get a grip on our attention, you know, like our desire for sex or the pleasure of witnessing spectacles of violence or whatnot. Those are all things that will hold human attention quite strongly. And the thing that becomes really interesting is the more that we liberate our own attention, the more power we do indeed regain. And one of the ways that I think we're most prone to imprisoning our attention is imprisoning it in self-judgment and negativity and doubt and fear and just sort of all these ways that we're taught to not like ourselves or not trust ourselves. It's a huge energy drain. I mean, it's bigger, it's a bigger attention drain than anything I can imagine.
So moving on to the next point of your article, number three here, scientific materialism is a fundamentalist religion. Couldn't agree more with you there as well, but please do explain your point.
So scientific materialism is sort of this notion that matter is all that exists. You know, what exists is what can be measured and quantified and objectified and known. And it's also this idea that even though matter is all that exists, in some big way, it's inert, it's dead. Like, you know, trees are just kind of objects and animals also just pointless objects and humans, you know, it's sort of, it's very disenchanted. It's very like this kind of cold, heartless, deadening, alienating thing. And it really does convince us that we live in a world where we're kind of alone as, you know, we're subjects that are just surrounded by objects instead of being subjects who are in relation to other subjects. You know, like if you look at indigenous cultures, they're usually talking about grandfather fire, grandmother moon. You know, there's this way in which animism especially has a very strong relatedness and intimacy with other subjects built into its worldview. We're in a worldview that's like the polar opposite of that, and that's really desolate and incredibly painful and depressing, which I think is, you know, part of why our society has the kind of mental health issues that it does and this opiate endemic. The way this is so insidious is this gets taught to us in schools, not as if it's a religion, not as if it's a choice to believe this, but as if this is reality. This just is reality. This is how things are. Nothing really has a soul. The soul doesn't exist. That's a fiction. Nothing. God doesn't exist. That's an old fiction too. That's reality, honey. And that sort of messaging of this is just reality, that's the same sort of messaging that the Catholic Church had in during the Dark Ages, right? It's like, it's a belief system that masquerades as fact in order to maintain better control over its adherence. And this belief system is just so embedded in everything, like at the university level, the government level. You know, scientists can't even get funding for research that in any way violates this dogmatic notion of inanimate deadness all around us. And so there's a way in which this worldview is very, very helpful to anybody who's currently maintaining power, because once again, it's disempowering. It's incredibly disempowering and depleting to believe that we are in this kind of object world, that we are each, that each of us is ineffective and isolated. Is a very, it's just a potent tool for controlling and limiting people.
Well, I've heard some people present research on the current scientific paradigm being essentially orchestrated by the Catholic Church. So your comparison there is a lot more valid than some people might realize. You know, just talking about it as a fundamentalist religion, you know, a quote here from your article, you wrote that what happens when you venture outside the orthodox tenets of a fundamentalist religion, you're ostracized, attacked, and ridiculed as sinful or insane. And this is exactly what happens to scholars and scientists who venture outside the orthodox tenets of scientific materialism. So you can see the religious comparison there is also pretty apt. So moving on to the next point, which we already talked about a little bit up front, the fourth key you have to understanding this conspiracy against magic is that the conspiracy against magic is identical to the conspiracy against the feminine. Like I said, we talked about this already. Is there any more to add to that point? You do have some good stuff in here about the witch hunts from Europe that might be worth talking about. I'm not really sure if you want to, but go ahead.
Well, I guess I feel like it's maybe safe to say that femininity is very inconvenient to a scientific materialist worldview because it's spontaneous. It's hard to talk about this without making big generalizations and abstractions, so I'm going to try to like dial down a little bit. Maybe I could put it best in these terms. I would say that the reason why it's scary, that the idea that magic is real and that we might all have access to it and we might all be connected and related, that idea is terrifying to our culture. And it's just as terrifying as the idea that women or feminine people might be completely as valuable and as important and as legitimate as men or the masculine. And maybe I should be even more personal about this. Like, I find that there's so that all the forms of knowing that are delegitimatized by our world are forms of knowing that women and feminine people tend to have the most access to. And so there's something intimidating about these forms of knowing. And there's something about it that, like I said, we're taught to... Actually, I'm just going to stop right here, Ryan, and let you ask me a question because I feel like I'm veering too much.
Well, I think it goes back to the topic of science that we were just on. You know, this idea of just knowing, which we all possess, is not something that you can measure externally or physically. It's not something that you can show somebody to prove that you are right. So... because of that, I think it is demonized culturally, especially here in the U.S. I don't know how it's treated in other parts of the world. I'm sure there are people that are more open to it than we are here. But to just piggyback off of what you said, yeah, I mean, we're sort of mocked and insulted when we just say, you know, I just know. I just know that it's true. I've had that experience in my life where I know something to be true. I tell somebody that it's true. I feel that it's true. They immediately get defensive about it, especially if it's something personal, right? Like they'll just get defensive and they'll fight back against it. I've lost lifelong friends to these sorts of exchanges, you know, where to me, I think being a friend and not to get too far off track here again, but being a friend is being honest. And I mean, that's just one aspect of it, but telling people, and that's probably love too, you know, being honest and telling people or showing people, you know, what they don't see, right? Mm-hmm. And however you acquire that knowledge, I think it's important to share that. So this idea of knowing, just personally, like I said, I've had this experience a couple of times with people that I've been really close to and just say, you know, I just know. Like, I remember one case specifically where I was giving a best friend of mine advice on a big life decision that he was ready to make, and he made the opposite of what I suggested he do based on my own intuition. And the scenario that I laid out for him did not transpire for a couple more years after that, but it transpired exactly as I had explained it to him. And, you know, I guess in hindsight, he shouldn't have taken my word for it. He has to learn on his own, right? But still, it's just, yeah, I was demonized and I lost a good friend of mine because of that experience. He did not like what I was telling him based on my own intuition of the situation. And yeah, so that one hits a little close to home for me, but I didn't ask you a question. I'm so sorry.
it's just talking about it is great. It's helping me think more fully about this. Yes, so it sounds like you had a very clear experience of this, you know, this part of this intuitive part of your being, which we might call like a sort of feminine knowing that just received this knowledge, of it being shamed and put down and treated as this offensive, horrible, how dare you thing. And that's, you know, that's what we do to the feminine in our world. And it's so interesting because it's like a huge amount of invalidation is needed. It's like the feminine has to be invalidated in order for the whole edifice to keep going in some way. If you give it an inch, if you like, even with a little bit, say like, oh, you know, maybe spontaneous knowing could be a thing. Maybe we are connected in some mysterious way. You know, just opening that up knocks down the sort of metaphysics of alienation that our whole society is built on.
Yeah. The last point here on your list, I don't know, maybe the most controversial, I'm not sure, but I happen to agree with it myself just based on what I know. And the last point is that the conspiracy against magic is connected to the conspiracy against black and brown people. And I don't want to make this racially charged because I don't believe it is.
So maybe I will go the safer route in answering this question and just read one or two lines from what I wrote, because it is sort of an observation based on like an intuition that I have. So here's how I explain it in the article, which is just that it's true that magic exists in all races and cultures. But if you think about some of the primary racist stereotypes used to put down black and brown people, it goes something like this. They're too wild, too irrational, too musical, too loud, too energetic, too sexual, too in the moment, too in their bodies, too angry, too disregarding of rational, polite quietness. In other words, they're too much in touch with their magic, their eros, their spark of life. So there's this way in which the sort of hierarchy of our society is like the more detached and rational and objective and scientific you can be, the better you are. And there's this association of women, of feminine people, of gay people, of black and brown people with this suppressed force of magic. So we're sort of we're made to, rightly or not, made to be the example of everything that is insufficiently objective or rational or scientific or logical.
You said that, you know, maybe some of these racial atrocities that we've seen transpire over the last few decades here, maybe that has something to do with the fact that as a people, white people are sort of alienated from their own magic, and then they sort of project that resentment onto everyone else who's still in touch with theirs on some level. I thought that was a really great point, and it's not something that I'd ever really considered, but it does make a lot of sense when you look at it. You know, magic is very real. I think we know that by now, that there's something there, there's something to it, and if you disconnect people from it, and it's kind of like if you're surrounded by a bunch of lies and bullshit and fakery, and you start to believe in that, and then that becomes your reality. Like, you've built your reality based off of deception and falsities. And then something real comes into that reality. It's going to look and act different than everything that you think is real. And you're going to reject that. And I think that's what we're talking about here, is that there is this sort of cultural injection of magic from these other races. And we, I don't think as a race ourselves, have really embraced that as a whole. So we reject it, you know, as real as it may be, we think it's fake because we're surrounded by a bunch of fakeness.
Yes, I think that's as good as an explanation of it as any, Ryan. It's deep. I mean, when I think about, you know, European white people, whatever we want to call it, of which I am one, what tends to spring into my mind is I think about the Roman conquest. And I think about, you know, there was a point at which all of these kind of indigenous magical tribes in Europe were taken over by another culture, which had a way of, which also, you know, even when Rome was pagan, there was still something about it that was not super enchanted, that was interested in this, how do I say, it's like, in a way, like white people, European people, we are the victims of colonization just as much as Native American or African people. It's just that our colonization happened a few thousand years before white people went and enacted more of that colonization on Native Americans, on African people. But those wounds of being separated from one's kind of tribal ways of knowing or shamanistic ways of knowing, I think those wounds are still like, are huge, huge in us.
That also is a good segue here, because there's another point I wanted to touch on, another piece that you've written that I wanted to touch on. And I think, too, we have to look at it from a generational perspective, because I don't know if you give any credence to the idea of, you know, this sort of new agey idea of indigo children, or however you want to label them, about people being born into this world with more heightened magical senses, and then they're really the target now. This millennial generation and then the Gen Z behind them are really the target of... Why Gen Z, by the way? That's the end of the line, isn't it? that's a whole other subject. But they seem to be like really targeted by... We talk about, you know, propaganda, marketing, advertising, and then these weird technological advancements that we keep hearing about. Like, they seem to be the target of all that, that the world that they're going to inhabit now and then later on in their lives is going to be completely different than the one that you and I were born into. And we're on the older end of the millennial generation, and I just can't fucking believe what I'm seeing. But you wrote a book to sort of tie this back into what I wanted to talk about. You co-wrote a book with a friend of yours called Pluto in Scorpio. The subtitle was An Occult Look at the Millennial Generation, or something like that. I didn't write the subtitle down. And I was wondering if we could touch on that, because I think you put it out maybe 2 years ago or 1 year ago. So it's a little older, and it's just a little, I think it's like maybe 80-page ebook. But I was wondering, you know, you began the book by discussing what the natal Pluto placements in general can indicate, and what Pluto in Scorpio could theoretically or mythologically signify. Could you go through that connection for us?
Maybe the way that I can best get into it is, Pluto I think of as being like the most intense point of energy in a birth chart, in the sense, obviously the sun is an intense point of energy, but Plutonic energy is obviously, it's like the hidden, the shadow, the mysterious, the deeper, and it's also the other in the grand sense that we were talking about before, sort of like the vast divinity, that when we think of like our little speck of a self and then this vastness. And I think that the Pluto placement in a birth chart can indicate a number of things, but one of the things that it indicates is the type of relationship that we have to mystery, or to this kind of unknown, shadowy, unconscious stuff. And Pluto in Scorpio is basically the most, which is the Pluto placement that everybody has in the millennial generation. I think it's everybody born from like 1984 to, I don't have the dates in front of me, it might be like 1995, I think, has Pluto in Scorpio. And this placement is really kind of an atomic level interest in change and an ability to be present with terrifying realities of death and transformation, because that's sort of what Scorpio is. It's these deep, dark, transpersonal mysteries that are in some sense ultimately impenetrable. But what I think is so fascinating about the Pluto and Scorpio generation is, first of all, this is the last generation with Pluto and Scorpio was the generation that enacted the French and the American revolutions. So there's this strong revolutionary energy in Pluto and Scorpio, this kind of willingness to transform and to go to any lengths. And there's also, of course, this comfort with the occult, with magic, with unexplainable things, with alchemy, with transmutation, that is really just shared by everybody in this generation. And I think more the millennial generation comes into maturity. So like you said, we're on the older end of the spectrum. I was born in 1984 myself, and I feel like I'm just really becoming an adult, like, now.
Yeah.
So as more people from the millennial generation kind of go through their Saturn returns, go through their maturing, individualizing process, I actually think the more prominent magic and mysticism is going to come in our culture. And I think there's going to be a widespread shift away both from dogmatic religion and from the religion of scientific materialism. And, you know, basically, I think we're in the midst of an occult renaissance that's only going to gain strength. And you mentioned like indigo children, and I think there's something there to that indigo child idea of just people who have a unique capacity for bringing in certain frequencies or certain energies that the planet really needs and or our human world really needs in order to continue. And I think that's really just true of the Pluto and Scorpio generation, that there is a quality of perception that comes with Pluto and Scorpio, which is unflinching, which is sort of willing to have ultimate transparency. You know, like one of the keys of this internet age where, like, everything you could ever want to know about anybody, like, it's all, if people volunteer it, we're putting everything out in the open. And that's, you know, the word apocalypse means revealing. It means showing something that was previously kept hidden. And so I think we are in the midst of an ongoing revelation, an ongoing apocalypse about what human nature really is and what our range of power really is.
This does seem like, if this generation is, you know, maybe a bit more magical, a bit more energetically sensitive and can use that for betterment, you know, for humanity, it does make sense that whatever sort of darkness is here already, that they would want to target us. They would want to target that group. And I mean, I sat down, I was born in 1983. My Pluto's at 0 degrees, Scorpio, by the way. So I was born like right at the beginning of this cycle. But I remember sitting down, you know, when I was 13, 14 years old, and I have this thing in front of me now called the internet. And then everything that has come with that since then is like, you know, it took a lot of the magic out of my life as a teenager. I realize it now. I didn't realize it then, but looking back, I'm like, how much time did I spend in front of that computer once we got it? You know, like as a young kid, I'm so grateful that I wasn't exposed to that we didn't have that around. But then I realized, well, as a teenager, I'm still in my formative years, you know, becoming an adult, but I'm kind of like you. I just turned 34 and I don't really feel like I'm an adult yet. I don't even know what that means. But yeah, I just realized like they have targeted this maybe intentionally from the onset of our formative years. Like they knew that at 13 or 14 years old that here's going to be this thing called the internet and we're going to shove it in front of all of these Pluto and Scorpio faces and they're just going to get so enraptured by it that it's going to just distract them from, you know, maybe doing what we're here to do as a group. So it was interesting that I didn't know that you wrote that book until I stumbled across your Conspiracy Against Magic article. So, but I was really, you know, as someone who's part of that generation, I'm also a Scorpio sun sign. So anything that has to do with Scorpio in general, I usually have a more of an interest in because I like to read about it. It is kind of the darkest of the signs, the more occult of the signs. So
yeah, I guess what I would just add to that is it's interesting, you know, bringing up the internet. I don't necessarily think of it as like, you know, the powers that be seduced us Pluto and Scorpio generation with the internet. I think almost of the internet as the synchronous reflection of what this Pluto and Scorpio generation is. In other words, you know, the internet is all knowledge, all information, all wisdom at your fingertips. Also, all pornography, all drugs, all vice, all mindlessness at your fingertips. And there's a way in which no other generation, maybe in the history of the world, has had such immediate access to so much virtue and vice and wisdom and idiocy as our generation has. Like you said, starting at such a young age when we were teenagers, we're the first humans to have the internet form us. We're the children of the internet in so many ways. And, you know, it's very interesting right now. Like, I think there were just some rules or something, a bill passed revoking net neutrality in the United States. And there's thoughts about what the consequences of that might be, you know, trying to shut corporations, perhaps trying to make portions of the internet unavailable or hard to access or, you know, shutting down or controlling. I feel like that could never last because I think there is something about the Pluto and Scorpio generation that is intent on the total sharing of all knowledge, of all experience, even like this kind of just total intimacy with reality, I think is the objective of Pluto and Scorpio. And I actually, that's one of my definitions of magic is intimacy with reality. So yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah. So you think about it, Ryan, like growing up with the internet, like you had to learn how to make the choice of like, oh, I'm going to spend my time looking for things that, you know, open my horizons instead of, I don't know, masturbating for 12 hours a day, which is the choice that some people make, right?
Made it before, yes.
I made it before, but you know, you grow out of it. I've made it a few times.
Definitely.
So, that's what I'm saying is like, when previous generations never even had the chance, they were never confronted with such a choice. They were never confronted with such a situation where you have to really learn to navigate the flood of everything.
If I had all of the hours that I've spent masturbating back, I'd be a completely different person, more well-read probably. I probably could have finished like a million books. But just to sort of tie that up, you know, that was, I took a more conspiratorial approach to that sort of segment there. That was my paranoia getting the better of me, and then your pronoia coming in and sort of saving the day here. So it was nice that we sort of got a little light and dark play there. Is there anything more about Generation Scorpio that we should pull out? I feel like there might be, but I'm not really sure. Like I said, it was a short book, and it was mostly comprised of like the actual broken up by the zodiac signs. So,
I mean, another thing that I think it's interesting to think about is that Pluto and Scorpio generation was born during the AIDS epidemic and the crack epidemic. And even if our families weren't individually touched by those forces, that's quite a little nexus to be born inside, this kind of very dramatic, dark nexus of addiction and death and sex and growing gender fluidity and gender equality. I think it's also interesting that the Harry Potter books were such a huge part of most millennials growing up in that it's a narrative about magic and ultimately a narrative about shadow integration, which I think we're really hungry for. The people with Pluto and Scorpio are especially hungry to just own and accept every single part of themselves. And let's see, some themes to notice associated with Pluto and Scorpio, I think, is really this understanding that all sensation is transmutable, that all pain can be pleasure and all pleasure can be pain. And I think that there's just a special kind of transmuting tantric quality of attention that's possible, which is the very thing that is needed to salvage anything basically from this kind of poison-filled world. To deal with this poison-filled world, you need a spiritual view, a spiritual approach that includes the ingesting of poison.
You know, it's interesting you mentioned Harry Potter too, because I actually didn't get into that right away, but as I got older into my late teens and early 20s, it was a huge part of my life. But now when I look at it, and I'm sure somebody's talked about this, I've been actually trying to find somebody to talk about this, but I haven't yet, but I'm sure somebody somewhere has written something about it or been on a podcast about it. But, you know, the fact that that's seven books and there's seven alchemical steps, I guess, had always intrigued me. Like when I learned more about alchemy, which is essentially shadow integration, right? You know, sort of transmuting darkness into light. You know, like you said with Harry Potter and Voldemort, who are light and dark representations, intimately connected, obviously, which is the alchemical process. And I would love to like reread that now as an adult, well, as a 34-year-old, and see like what sort of symbols that are in there that I missed when I read it years ago. Like having that more magical alchemical worldview and being able to revisit that and see like what sort of occult messaging is in there, what sort of references are in there. I mean, you obviously Nicholas Flamel, right, in that first book, which was, he was a famous alchemist. So I'm just rambling here because I get excited about Harry Potter because I want to talk about it at that level and I just haven't really been able to yet. So do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, I am not the most astute Harry Potter scholar that there is. I bet that you could go back through the books and find really interesting correspondences with the stages of alchemy and the different stories there. But yeah, I just think it's the kind of, once again, a sort of pronoic point of view. I think that book and that story and that mythology was kind of generously given to us Pluto and Scorpio people almost as a way of, you know, reminding us about the possibilities of alchemy and magic and transformation and teaching us that being a muggle isn't the best thing.
<don't>... Yeah, it's definitely a very seemingly boring and less interesting existence for sure. So I think that's probably a good place to wrap up at Carolyn. We've mentioned Bad Witch a couple of times. Badwitch.es is your website. Is there any place else if people want more of your work that they could find you at?
Yeah, I have another website called CarolynGraceElliott.com, where I write sort of more businessy essays about online business, usually, because that's another big interest of mine. I run a fairly substantially large online business. And there's a book that I wrote called Awaken Your Genius, which is for sale through the Amazon store. You can find it, which is all about creativity and getting better access to one's own personal genius. And I'm working on a book right now, which will be out from Red Wheel Wiser in January 2019, that's all about a process that I teach called existential kink, which is a rapid shadow integration process.
Oh, man. I developed a decent relationship with the folks at Red Wheel Wiser, so hopefully when that gets out, I can give you a call again and we can chat more about that. And the title sounds amazing, obviously. So, Carolyn Elliott, thanks so much for your time. I appreciate it. It's nice chatting with you. Nice to meet you. I hope to have you back again sometime.
Oh, likewise. Thank you, Ryan.
And there you have it. My thanks again to Carolyn Elliott, Dr. Carolyn Elliott. Be sure to check out her work if you're interested. It is linked in the show notes. And be sure to do your part in helping overcome this conspiracy against magic, because it isn't just a conspiracy against a set of beliefs or practices. It's a conspiracy against you, and it's a conspiracy against your power. And it doesn't matter when you were born or what you look like or where you came from. You and I and everyone are powerful witches, powerful magicians, and it's time we realize that. Also, please be sure to support the show in any way you can, because this right here, this is the spell. This podcast is the spell. My voice is the spell. Your voice is the spell. This is the magic. And the easiest way to help spread this magic is to leave us a 5-star review on iTunes. That helps grow the audience tremendously. Oh, and speaking of that, the show has now done more than 250,000 downloads across all platforms. We crossed that number sometime recently, and for a little startup podcast in a niche genre that's 100% listener-supported, I think that's pretty cool. So thank you to every single one of you who's ever downloaded an episode. I appreciate that so much. Of course, if you're interested in getting more involved, check out our Patreon campaign. We call it CODA. That's at patreon.com/oldculture, linked in the show notes. You'll get access to all of our episodes before everyone else, bonus episodes exclusively for patrons, opportunities to co-host episodes with me, and chances to win free shit. But if a recurring monthly thing ain't your thing, oldculturepodcast.com/donate has more options to help support the show. And you can also hit up oldculturepodcast.com/merch or our Etsy store to grab our official logo t-shirt. Anyway, enough of my gratuitous marketing plugs. I gotta get out of here. Until next time, you've just been initiated into oldculture. I am Ryan Peverly, reminding you to love yourself, think for yourself, and question authority.
Please rewind this cassette.